Colors, halt. Ready. Post. Colors. Ready. Cut. Present. Arms.
Ladies and gentlemen, be seated. Could we have a quick round of applause for the color guard and the horns? Now gives me great pleasure to introduce the superintendent of Virginia Military Institute, General Binford P. III. Sir.
Well, good morning, everybody. Governor McAuliffe, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Virginia Military Institute for this, the 28th Annual Environment Virginia Symposium. VMI is very proud to be the host of this annual conference, along with our co-host, the Virginia Department of Environmental Quality, the Virginia Department of Conservation and Recreation, and the Virginia Environment Endowment, which incidentally is celebrating its 40th anniversary this year, and has worked with us on several special occasions and offerings for this conference. The Environment Virginia Symposium is known for inviting a free exchange between individuals, businesses, government agencies, and nonprofits for the greater environmental good and the best for Virginia. As in years past, this year's conference provides a useful forum to examine the relationship between environmental stewardship and economic development for the prosperity and well-being of all citizens in the Commonwealth. Our theme, as Dave mentioned, this year is Virginia's Environment, Shaping a Sustainable Future. And it reflects the type of forward thinking I think needed to preserve and enhance the natural resources of our Commonwealth. During this conference, you will have an opportunity to hear and confer with experts in all aspects of environmental management policy, education, and science. In addition to more than 40 breakout sessions that we have planned, the agenda features special sessions on environmental careers, business procurement opportunities, and a hot topic session with some of our state's top environmental leaders in business, government, and the nonprofits. And tomorrow, you will hear from our plenary speaker, Bill Sherman, CEO of Future 500. VMI, as you know, has hosted this conference since its inception, and Captain Ronald A. Urchell, U.S. Navy retired, a professor of geology and civil engineering at the Institute for over 27 years, conceived the Environmental Virginia Symposium in 1990. He coordinated its annual meetings until his retirement. He was a 1961 graduate of the United States Naval Academy. He earned a master's degree from the Naval Postgraduate School and the PhD from Rhode Island in ocean engineering. And in his honor, VMI established the Urchell Environmental Leadership Award, which is presented each year at this conference. Captain Urchell passed away in 2011. But he envisioned a conference characterized by a strong sense of community. We have tried to follow his vision by working closely each year with a planning committee of government, nonprofit, and industry environmental professionals who work together to organize this particular conference. We welcome your feedback on our conference by surveys every year, and with the committee's help, we're proud to bring you a diversity of viewpoints through strong panels and presentations on environment topics of great importance to our state. This year's committee members' names are listed in your program, and I will not repeat each tonight. We thank them for their service, and in addition, many of our exhibitors and sponsors have been part of this conference for years as well, for which I also extend our warmest thanks. And welcome back. At VMI, we are proud of our environmental programs in the sciences and engineering. These programs are part of a long tradition at the Institute of Concern for Environment and the Economy of the Commonwealth, starting really with the introduction of our courses in the application of chemistry to agriculture over 150 years ago. On behalf of the faculty, staff, and VMI, I extend you a warm welcome. I hope you have a stimulating conference and that you enjoy your time at VMI in historic Lexington. It's now my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, the 72nd Governor of Virginia, the Honorable Terry McAuliffe, who is making his third visit to this symposium and fourth to VMI. And I know that the governor really needs no introduction to this audience. But his successes in economic development, education, and environmental improvements are all testaments to his strong work, his ethic, his passionate commitment to the Commonwealth. We all know his signature work in building a new Virginia economy for the 21st century with industries like cybersecurity, biosciences, advanced manufacturing. Twice elected chairman of the Chesapeake Bay Executive Council, he has taken the lead and has taken the lead in cleaning up the bay while diversifying Virginia's energy base. He really has been a friend to our military and its veterans through initiatives on job transition and health care access, and he has led Virginia to become the first state in the nation to end veteran homelessness. He has been a special friend of the Virginia Military Institute over the years. It's my pleasure to introduce the Honorable Terry McAuliffe, the 72nd Governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia, and welcome him to Environmental Virginia. Governor McAuliffe.
Thank you, General. Great to see you. Thank you, everybody. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Thank you. Sit down, relax. What an honor to be back with you. I'm proud to say the first governor that has attended this conference 3 years in a row. If you change the Constitution, I could run again, I'd be back, but that's not likely to happen. But actually, I have a big day back in Richmond, but I did want to be here today. Today, as you know, I've broken the record of the most vetoes of any governor in Virginia history. I have 111 vetoes. I told everybody in the legislature, if you do anything that will harm our environment, try and put more needles, guns on the street, discriminate against anybody, women, anybody out there, I'll veto it, and that's what I've done. And today, I'm very proud. I believe all my vetoes will be sustained. I will be 111-0 by the end of today, folks. So this is a big issue for us, and I want to thank VMI. I love coming to this annual conference here. I want to thank VMI for all the great work they do with our Virginia folks and what they do for our military. I want to thank General P and Colonel Gray for putting this together today. I really appreciate all the great work that they have done. I'm here to talk to you about the environment once again. And when you think about where we were and where we are today in Virginia, it is an extraordinary change over the course of the last 3 years. As General P said, I have focused everything on economic development. I say you cannot grow an economy if you're not protecting your natural assets. Tourism is a gigantic piece of our business, $23 billion of tourism income last year. Well, a big part of that is to make sure that our bay is clean, that people can visit it, all of our rivers, streams we have, the beautiful mountains we have, our ocean. You know, we have got to do and continue to do a great job to protect these valuable assets economically, and so we have really leaned in on these issues. I'm proud in the last 3 years. When I became governor, our unemployment rate was 5.4. I announced last week we've dropped it all the way to 3.9. That is the lowest level we have had in 9 years. We have brought in about $16 billion of new economic development projects, 902. Not that we're counting, but you should tell your children tonight at bed. $5 billion more than any governor in the history of the Commonwealth. And our unemployment claims just reached a 44-year low, lowest we've had since 1973. And I will give a lot of credit is that we in Virginia are sending a message that we protect our environment, that we are going to lean in. I understand this economically. We have the largest naval base in the world down in the Hampton Roads region. I have to clearly send a signal to the U.S. Navy that we understand these issues. Climate change is real. It is happening. As you know, I had to reestablish the climate. Thank you. My predecessor, for whatever reasons they had in that administration, you were not allowed to use the word climate change in the administration. I changed that day one. Climate change, climate change, climate change. I use it every day. It's real. It's happening. And we cannot literally be like an ostrich putting our head into the ground. You cannot bury your head in the sand, not understand it's happening. You go to Hampton Roads, anytime it rains, half the roads are closed down in Norfolk. I was recently with the mayor down there. We went after a 45-minute, it was a heavy rain, 45 minutes. We were going from one location to another. Half the roads were closed down. Folks, this is happening. It is real. And we need to get in the game. And so I have not shied away from one of these issues and the battles that sometimes we've had with the General Assembly on this issue. Water is a big deal to us here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. I know we got our head of DEQ, Dave Paller. My first week I met with Dave Paller, I asked him, what is it that keeps you up at night? He said, the Potomac Aquifer. He said, I am petrified of what is happening to the depletion of our aquifer. So we got to work. We don't issue the permits that we used to, which used to take a lot of water out of our aquifer. We've now put a plan in place to protect it. And just last week with the Hampton Roads Sanitation District, we were down there for an innovative new program that we're all jointly financing that is now going to put back into the aquifer. It's going to put drinking water back in through the latest technology. Whatever we take out, we are going to put back in. So we are going to rehydrate our aquifer so that we can continue to use that as a great asset. That was a revolutionary thing we did. We announced that last week. And I do want to thank Dave Paller for his tremendous leadership on our aquifer and the great work that he has done. We've worked hard to protect all our rivers and streams. I was very proud that we just got the largest environmental settlement in Virginia history to protect the Shenandoah area. We had had from DuPont, we had had mercury poisoning that had gone on, and they have just written us a check for $50 million, which we are now going to use in the areas to make it better, to clean up what they have done, to make sure that is a valuable asset. So we have been aggressive also legally. If you come in and you harm our resources, we are going to come after you. I don't care who you are. And we're going to get money, and we're going to make right what you made wrong. And so that was the largest settlement, and that would not have happened without our Secretary of Natural Resources. So let's give Molly Ward a great round of applause for the work that she has done. But we're really working on all these great water assets. As the General mentioned, I'm also chairman of the Executive Council. That is all the governors who are in charge of the headwater states, as well as the District of Columbia. I just got reelected. I'm very proud, unanimously. I got 7 votes, first governor to ever be reelected. But folks, this Bay asset is so important to the Commonwealth of Virginia. It is a $1 trillion asset, generates at full capacity about $130 billion a year. It's the people who visit it, it's the people who fish it, it's the people who live on it. And the idea that we are not protecting that for future generations, so we have really leaned in. I'm proud to say we're the first governor that we fully funded our water quality investment fund to make sure we're doing our part so these wastewater treatment facilities are no longer dumping into our beautiful Chesapeake Bay. So we have fully funded that. We're meeting all of our targets. In fact, we have met our target a decade early, which is really a testament to everybody who works hard on these issues. Very important for us. We're working with the farmers. We got to keep the cattle out of our streams and lakes and all that, as you know, because we don't want them polluting our beautiful streams. I tell the story last year, visiting one of our state parks, James River State Park, we took a nice 15-mile kayak, the whole family going down, and we turned a bend, and my wife Dorothy said, let's jump in the water. Just as we went around the bend and pull our kayaks off, there were 10 cows doing their duty right there in the stream. I said, I'll be honest with you, honey, I'm not getting in the river right now. I'll wait, go back to the hotel and take my shower. But it's real, so we're working hard to work with the farmers. And listen, our farmers, this is their livelihood. They want to do everything they possibly can to protect our environment, but, you know, it takes money to do that, so we've leaned in. And the results have just been extraordinary. The blue catfish in the bay, we've doubled. Our harvest of our oysters are back dramatically, which is, and our crabs are way up. So we are making real progress. I am very concerned. As you know, I've been very vocal. I do not agree with our new president on many things, but I do not agree with him on the issues of the environment. He has called for the cutting of all funding for the Chesapeake Bay cleanup. That is $73 million a year. Are you kidding me? Right. Let's stop Donald Trump from taking our Chesapeake funding away. That's an applause line. And I just don't understand it because, listen, we lean in. We love our environment here in Virginia. But I can promise you this. We have had very tough negotiations and conversations with the other governors. There are some states who are making progress, but they're way, way behind. Pennsylvania needs to do a lot more work. So if you take this funding away, we'll continue to lean in here in Virginia. But it really doesn't matter because the water comes down from Pennsylvania. Those headwater states in the Chesapeake Bay, they're going to stop. And that's going to affect us. So we got to get, you know, serious about this and do what we need to do. So I'm very proud. We met our target, which people were shocked at. Our targets on the Chesapeake Bay, you know, we signed the 2014 Chesapeake Bay Agreement. All the governors signed it. I am very proud that we've met our target this year, but we have zero chance of meeting the 2025 target if they take this funding away. So this is something we'll lean in. I hosted all the Virginia congressional delegation in Washington last week. I went through the items that I have issues with, but this was my number one concern, and I do think that we'll have a lot of folks that will be able to come together to fight that because it just doesn't make any sense, as I say. You know, this is a huge tourism asset. $63 million a day is spent in tourism. So we've got to continue to work that. I've also leaned in on issues that are very important to Virginia's future. We have had a big issue here on coal ash. As you know, the federal government has ordered our coal ash ponds, all of us in the country that have coal ash ponds, for them to be closed. We have moved ahead. I know DEQ, the permitting process that we have in Virginia, is stronger than the state law requires, as well as the EPA. But in addition, David and I talked the other day, I have just put an amendment in, which will be voted on today. I'm not comfortable where we are, folks. I'm just not comfortable. So I have put an amendment in that I want to delay any movement on these coal ash ponds until May of 2018. I want a full study back. I want to know the environmental impact that's going to happen on moving this, what we're doing on these coal ash. Are we doing the right thing environmentally and financially? And if you get a chance today, I would hope you could call your General Assembly member because that amendment's coming up today for a vote. It is very important. I'm just not comfortable. We have to do a better job on the coal ash, and I just don't want anything done until I know we are leading the nation. So if you get a chance today, I'd ask you to lean in. I also leaned in on the issue of fracking. They had bills, believe it or not, this year. You know, I don't know where they get these bills, but they had bills that if you frack in Virginia, they wanted to give the businesses a FOIA exemption so they did not have to disclose what they were using to put into our land. Now, let me be very clear, folks. You come into Virginia, you are going to inject anything into our water. I want to know exactly what you're putting that into our water. So we were able to get that done, and we won that. We got that. So if there's anything going on, they now have to disclose to us. But, you know, had we not taken action, believe it or not, we would never know what they may be injecting. This is our land, okay? You put it in our land, I want to know what's going in the land. So we were very successful in getting that done. I'm very proud of what we have done on the renewables. I'm trying to help all the communities, as I say, on economic development. Since we've been in office, we've created 191,600 jobs. Another fun fact for your children tonight. And big part of that is renewables. Folks, we have got to get in the game. As I say, when I took office, we were not in the game on renewable energy. We now, when you think when I took office, we had 17 megawatts of solar installed. That is it. That is an embarrassment. And today, we're already over 400. We've had a 25% increase. This is important. Obviously, you've got to have a renewable energy as part of your mix. I'm hoping to announce soon. I'm hoping. We're working hard, Great team. I'm the first wind turbine in Virginia. You know, I'm not trying to recreate the world, but we got to get in the game on these renewables, and I'm hoping I could announce that very shortly. But we literally, folks, have taken solar to the next level, and I'm trying to make sure this is how you create jobs in economically depressed areas. You go to Southside and Southwest, textile, furniture, coal, tobacco, those jobs, they've been lost. You know, we are a coal state. We're considered a coal state. We have 4.3 million workers in Virginia today. Do you know how many actually work in the coal business? Take a guess. 75,000. 1,016. People don't understand that. So what I've tried to do in communities that lost these jobs, I have 3,500 solar jobs already in 2 years. Work with me in these renewable spaces. This is the jobs of the 21st century. We've got to move forward aggressively. We ought to be manufacturing the panels here. I mean, I'm on a tirade. I just announced the largest solar field in the entire Mid-Atlantic, second largest in the entire East Coast, down in Accomack, with a partnership with Amazon. It was a great announcement, spectacular. The end of the press conference with the cameras rolling. I went over and looked at the beautiful solar panels that the company brought down. I looked on the top of it, said, made in Georgia. I almost took a hammer to those solar panels. You don't come to Virginia with solar panels made in Georgia. So I'm really trying to tell these solar companies, I want a manufacturing facility here. I mean, that's what we have to do. But as I say, folks, these are great jobs for the future. Last year, we got about $120 million resiliency grant from the federal government, the largest of any state in the United States of America. Why? They know we're serious about this, and we had a great plan that we put forward. And it's very important for us as we go forward. And we've taken the recommendations of the resiliency committee that we put together. So, folks, we're leaning in here on the environment. We're making great progress on our air and our water and our land. We got a long way to go, but let me tell you this, we cannot take our foot off the gas, and that's why we need to work with this new administration to do what we need to do. And I'd say, finally, the other area we've leaned in, we need, you're all here, you're passionate, you all love the environment, and I thank you for that. But we got to bring the average age down a little bit. How do we do that? We got to get more folks at a young age understanding the value in the environment. I think the outdoors, getting more folks outdoors, making sure that in here at VMI, they teach environmental issues, as many of our institutions of higher education. We got to get that earlier in the K through 12 to understand the value, the importance of our environment on education, but also these are the jobs of the 21st century. I'm very proud of the work we've done on our Virginia treasures, our Virginia State Parks. In fact, on Sunday, I was just up at Lake Anna. That was my 34th state park. I'm proud to say on April 19th, I will be the first governor of Virginia history. We'll have visited all 37 of our state parks. We're 34. I've got three to go. We're going to finish that up. These parks are magnificent. We have a lot of great events. On Saturday, we did a nature preserve, a crow's nest up in Fredericksburg area. I mean, these are great things. We just got to get more young people out and visiting our state parks and understanding the value of everything that we do at our parks. Speaking of treasures, we have two treasures with us here today. I'd like them to come on up here. So if Joe could come up and Dixon could come up on behalf of the Virginia Environmental Endowment Fund. As you know, folks, it is 40th anniversary, and I cannot tell you the great work that these folks have done on our Virginia Endowment, Environmental Endowment. I actually have a proclamation somewhere. Okay, Molly, where'd you hide the proclamation? I swear to you, I got a proclamation. Anybody have the proclamation? Well, while we're waiting for the proclamation, why don't we have Joe and Dixon say a couple words about your 40th anniversary? How is that? Come on, Joe, the executive director. Thank you, buddy. I got one here somewhere.
Well, we're so appreciative of the governor and of his proclamation on behalf of our 40th anniversary. We've already seen a copy of it,
okay. So
we don't have the original with us. But it is very fitting that we're receiving it here at VMI, where we've been the co-host with the Institute since the very beginning. The endowment has worked with nearly 500 different partners in our four decades and have made so many improvements, so much of that due to all of the partners, the agencies, the universities, the nonprofit organizations that we've worked with. And we really salute all of you because our success is your success. And so we're very thankful this morning for the recognition.
Great.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you. Dixon, you want to say anything?
Okay.
Sure, you're here. Come on, Dixon.
I learned a long time ago growing up here that in Virginia, we do things a little differently. And I think that's part of, we know that the way to solve environmental problems is to bring all the people to the table and get consensus on an asset, an environment that we all communally treasure. So that sense of community has made a tremendous difference. And VEE, from its first set of seven directors on through, has always had that commitment to community, to working, to pull everybody together, make the right decisions rather than fight with each other, and get the job done. And thank you so much, Governor, for your recognition.
Thank you, Dixon.
Well, so I guess we are going to mail them the most beautiful proclamation we have ever had before. Thank you, guys. And I tell you, these folks are so important. And we're going to have a big challenge coming up. As you know, the president and the new secretary up there have basically tried to roll back all things related to President Obama's Clean Power Plan. So we're going to have, you know, our hands full dealing with that issue, which is very important for us. I signed an Executive Order 57. Regardless of what the federal government does, we are going to continue ourselves here. And that task force around Executive Order 57, they are putting the recommendations to me. And you will be hearing some actions that I will be taking through executive authority in early May. Because at the end of the day, I don't care what the federal government does. We here in Virginia have to lean in on the environment. And we are going to lean in on the environment. And I have time now for a couple questions, if anybody has any questions. Here's a mic. Wow. Here's a young woman over here.
I actually have a really loud voice.
Okay, great. Yeah. In fact, where's Molly? Come on up, Molly. Come on over here. Why'd you take the funding out? I put it in. I have no idea why she took it out.
Yeah. Sir, I was trying to track down the proclamation, so. So the question was about funding for stream cleanup. Certainly. Right. Now, this has been very much on the front of our plate and is a deep concern. We know that this water cleanup effort for localities is a tremendous burden and a difficult lift. It's just been a funding issue, and it's not that it's not a priority. We're trying to get, you know, through the stream, Water Quality Improvement Fund challenges first, and trying to make sure our soil water conservation districts are well funded, and then SLAF will definitely be next on our list. It's just a question of a limitation of resources. But
when's the last time we put money in that in Virginia history?
You know? Russ, do you know? 2 years ago. I 2 years ago. But it's definitely something that we worry about and think about. And as we look at the governor's, you know, budget, outgoing budget, certainly will be something that we discuss very seriously.
I'll put it back in my budget that I'm doing before I leave. Know why they keep taking my initiatives out behind my back. But, you know, the good news is that the budget's stronger last year. We're not quite sure. Payroll withholding was down, which is your which is the number of people who work in your state. Happily, this year, we're up 5%. We're leading the nation today. We now have the second lowest unemployment of any major state in America. So, you know, hopefully we can keep that trend line so we have funding for everything that we want to do. We met some challenges last year. I will also caution you, as much as I love good news and things are going great, I am very concerned. We do have some serious economic headwinds coming our way. I was just talking to General P. I met with General Mattis the other day, our Secretary of Defense. It looks like there's going to be another continuing resolution in October going forward. That is absolutely devastating for us here in Virginia. We're the number one recipient of Department of Defense dollars. A continuing resolution, no new funding. And that really could impact us. And, as I say, the president, his budget taking money out of Appalachian Regional Commission, LIHEAP, elderly folks getting heating. So I know his budget's not, most of us not going to see the reality of the day, but unfortunately, I do think a continuing resolution is most likely. I wish Washington could finally get their act together. They do absolutely nothing, and they're hurting us. We have to have a balanced budget here. We got to pass one every year. I wish the federal government would act the same way, because it really will have a debilitating. That's why I've leaned in on solar, on data analytics, renewable energy. These are the jobs of the 21st century, no matter what happens with defense spending. That's why we've really leaned in. I will tell all you parents here today that, you know, we're now the leader in America on cyber. We've gone from zero. We now have more companies. But I have 36,000 jobs open right now in Virginia, open today. Starting pay is $88,000. Parents, listen to me. Now, you're all so young, but there used to be a movie called The Graduate, and plastics was the key phrase. I tell you, it's cyber today. I got to fill these jobs, or else they're going to go elsewhere. So that's why I put $1 billion, the largest investment ever in education last year, to redesign our high schools. They don't work anymore in America. They're big buildings with classroom, with seats. They don't work. We're graduating students, $30 billion of student debt in Virginia today. $30 billion, many, not here at VMI, of course, but in many of our institutions of higher education, they're graduating without any skills to match all these jobs I have open. I mean, bringing that connective tissue for education is really, and that's why I got rid of 5 SOLs. We have too many SOLs here in Virginia. I've added computer science and code running to SOLs to fix it. So we're making progress, but it's great news, but we do face some big headwinds. Anybody else? Yeah, we in the back there.
Thanks. Elizabeth Andrews, Virginia Coastal Policy Center, William & Mary Law School. First of all, thank you again for your support of the Commonwealth Center for Recurrent Flooding Resiliency. Appreciate that. Great foresight on your and the legislature's part. There's been a lot of discussion in general and here over the last couple of days about the president's proposed cuts to the Bay program, and appropriately so. But the budget also proposes it cutting the NOAA budget and getting rid of some of our most important coastal resiliency program dollars. And I was wondering if that's on your radar screen as well, and what we can do in Virginia to help compensate for that.
Yeah. We are now systematically going through the president's proposed budget. He literally will impact every part of how we do business here in Virginia. But on the environmental, the NOAA budget, all of that is so important to us. I mean, look what he proposed cutting on the Coast Guard. You know, we're one of the main Coast Guard bases here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. So we are literally going through everything. I met with the congressional delegation the other day. We gave him our top 10 list of things that we're working on. We're going to try and go back. Now, this is his proposed budget. Congress has already said this thing is DOA, just not going to see the light of day. But you make a valid point, because I do worry if he's making X cuts at a dollar, maybe they compromise at 50 cents. At 50 cents, cutting the NOAA budget, they can't survive, as many of the other different areas. But, and listen, when the president got elected, I sent him a letter. I've known the man for 20 years. I sent him a letter and saying, listen, I'm also chairman of all the governors. I'm the chairman of the National Governors Association, so I've got to obviously work with the White House a lot, and I speak for all the governors. We're willing to work with anybody on health care, on infrastructure, tax reform. I'm open. I'll sit with anybody. I come from a business background. I've started 30 companies. I mean, compromise is something you do, and I'm trying to run our government like a business more effectively and efficiently. But unfortunately, they have never come back to work with us on anything. And I say today, the president's been a one-man wrecking crew to the Virginia economy, from the federal hiring freeze. I mean, right now, we're trying to get young people to go work for the federal government. We are at a dearth of young people working in the federal government. Putting a federal hiring freeze does not help us do that. The health care costs, all of you who are Virginia residents should understand that that's going to cost me anywhere from $708 million to $1.3 billion right off the bat on health care. I mean, think of that. All the environmental cuts that he has done are just devastating, and his lack of leadership on defense and intelligence issues is really problematic for us going forward. He said, oh, you know, I saw the president. He said, oh, Terry, I'll get you a new aircraft carrier. Well, you know, that's not how defense is done, but okay, Mr. President. But let's say he's right. And that was pretty funny. It was at a White House dinner. He says, Mike, come on over. Pence, the vice president. Tell Terry we're going to get him another aircraft carrier. Oh, you know, you get me a new aircraft carrier, in fairness, folks, that's 15 years down the road. I'm worried about cuts today to military, just the maintenance on our existing carriers and everything else. You know, I met with the Fleet Forces commander the other day, Admiral down there, and, you know, what they're proposing is going to happen down there is going to be devastating economically. So, you know, it is what it is. As you know, I was on the other side. I did not support the president. I was a very active Hillary Clinton supporter. At the end of the day, folks, I'm still disgusted that 92 million Americans didn't vote on Election Day. And now they all come up to me, oh, I wish I'd voted. Well, yeah, I'm sorry. I wish you had, too. And, you know, we had a bunch of protests in Richmond. Half the protesters that had gotten arrested didn't vote. No offense, you didn't vote. You don't have the right to protest. I'm sorry. I have zero tolerance for that. So, so we are where we are. We'll continue to do it. But, you know, we got infrastructure coming up, tax reform, and, you know, the health care debate. You've all heard me talk about it. I have an amendment today, you know, in the General Assembly to allow us to do Medicaid expansion. Put the politics out of this, folks. I am just, breaks my heart that we have forfeited. You should all know this. How many are Virginia taxpayers? Good. You should honestly know this if you didn't know it. As of today, we have forfeited $10.4 billion. Billion. Gone, I'll never get it back. Whether you dislike President Obama, it doesn't really matter to me, or you don't like health care, it's the law of the land. And we lose $6.6 million a day. You pay it, whether you like it or not. You ship it to Washington, you get 100% back. I could provide health care for 400,000 Virginians. I could create 50,000 new jobs. I could save our hospitals. And because of the General Assembly, who, for one reason, they are terrified of the Tea Party, and they will lose their June primary if they vote for Medicaid expansion, and they could lose a job that pays them $17,300 a year. I'm sorry. I just don't go into politics. I go into, as you all know, I lean in. You know, as you know, I just got the record. I've restored more rights for citizens than any governor in the history of the United States of America. And what happened? I got sued twice. Got sued by the speaker and the leader. Then they sued me for contempt of court. I'm the first governor to be sued for contempt of court. I told my attorney general, let me go over to, I'll go over to jail for a couple days. What the heck? And instead of letters from Birmingham, we'll have letters from Richmond. You know, the butler at the man, he'd bring me lunch. I could probably lose a few pounds. I mean, what the heck? But we got it done. They've finally done it. And now we've restored these rights. So I always lean in. But this is really bothersome to me, the Medicaid expansion. Because in fairness, people are dying. And you are spending now money, state dollars that the federal already paid for. So you've paid for it twice. I mean, when you go to an emergency room under federal law, you have to treat those individuals. Who do you think's paying for it? You are. You're just paying twice. And you go to the Ram Clinic, and people say, well, why are you so passionate? When I travel around the Commonwealth, women grab my arm and say, I'll be dead. Help me. And it's just unfortunate, you know, I've gotten 90% of what I wanted done, and since I've been in office, on education and transportation and job creation. You know, the social issues, we vehemently disagree, and open and welcoming, you know, what you do, I mean, I like everybody. You know, I am a fiscally conservative, pro-business Democrat. I'm socially progressive. At the end of the day, when you're open and welcoming, just look at North Carolina. They've lost $3.63 billion in economic development because of their HB2 bill. Well, I had an HB2 bill here, too. doesn't see the light of day as long as I'm sitting in the governor's chair. So, but the environment has always been a passion. We love the outdoors. We go to all these parks. And I don't do, you know, helicopter in, do a rub. We go, we spend the weekends. I mean, we got beautiful cabins. You should all go to our parks. Beautiful cabins, 37 of these. I mean, we've got it all here. Low taxes, business friendly. We got mountains. We've got the ocean. We don't have sharks in our water. We have dolphins at Virginia Beach. They come up to the beach. They pick up your children. They give them a ride. They drop them back in. I just opened our 297th winery. Think of that. We've moved into fifth place in the country. I want to be one by the time I leave. By the time I'm done, they're going to think Napa is an auto parts company. We're going to destroy them. 182 craft breweries. I just opened the 182nd. We now have 8 varieties of oysters. I just added a new variety from Tanger Island. You come to Virginia, you eat our oysters, you drink our wine. Virginia's for lovers. You figure the rest out. I can't do everything. But I mean, honestly, folks, it's going great. So, you know, this team over here has just been absolutely phenomenal in helping us protect our environment. Protecting our environment is the right thing to do morally. It's the right thing to do financially. It's the right thing to do socially. And we owe it to our children. And you're all here because you love our environment. So I just want to thank you for the great partnership I've had. It's great to be here 3 years in a row. We got 9 months to go. We're going to come out with some big issues on the clean power plan. We are not giving up. We're going to continue to fight. And I just want to thank you for being in that battle with us here. Thank you very much. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Sir, thank you again for your very insightful comments and for all that you've done to make Virginia a very healthy environment and more to come after that. On behalf of the superintendent, the Corps of Cadets, the staff and faculty, please accept this small gift that I think you can use with the next time you visit a state park to keep on asthma.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Can I open it now? Mm-hmm. Thank you, Colonel. Make me an honorary cadet?
Sure, that would be the first captain.
Oh, isn't that beautiful? Oh, look at that, everybody. That is great. Thank you. Thank you, Colonel. But I'm telling you, folks, this VMI is such a jewel for us here in Virginia. You go out and look at these cadets when you go out and you walk around. Man, they are there. They are. They love our country. They love this Commonwealth. And we are just so blessed that VMI is here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. You look at their storied, magnificent history. And just another jewel in the great why we are the greatest state and the greatest nation on earth. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Colonel. Great.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the governor's remarks. We'll move on to our opening panels after a short break. Refreshments are outside. Thank you very much for your attention.